Yes.
Oh, such a beautiful day, too, to praise God and give Him glory for what He's done for you this week. Amen. Let's lift Him up. Amen.
Yeah. I praise you this morning, God. You're the same God today, and the same God tomorrow. Help me see the victory you've already seen. Let my faith be today what it will be tomorrow. And when I see the victory you already see, oh, Jesus, I believe. Oh, for your glory. Oh, the sick are healed, the soul is healed, the battle has been won. On your promise I stand, oh, in faith I believe in that what I pray in your name, it's already done. Oh, let your will be done. Oh, of your name and all for your glory. The sick are healed, the soul is healed, the battle has been won. On your promise I stand, oh, in faith I believe in that when I pray in your name, it's already done. Oh, oh, we need a miracle. You are the miracle maker, God of the impossible. There is no power greater, exceeding abundant, beyond what we could ask or think. There is no
Praise God. We love you, Jesus.
Hallelujah,
Lord. We know
Jesus.
You are the miracle worker, Lord, and you make miracles happen, God. We are thankful, Lord, for what you're doing in our life. Oh, mighty God, continue to move in us to this day. God put on my heart to share with y'all something about some positive news and some miracle working that he is doing in our country. We hear a lot of negative. I want to deliver some positive to you. So John Maxwell, if you don't know, he's a leadership expert, and his mission right now is to bring leadership into the school systems of the United States of America. Now, everything John knows about leadership is all things that he learned from God, all things that are biblical. So in turn, in a way, he's bringing biblical leadership to the school systems. Now, a door has opened up that they've been knocking on for years. John said, we've been knocking for years and years, and the government would not open up this door for us. But for some reason, he believes God is now opening up a door that the government in South Carolina has opened up their school systems to allow John and his team to come in and begin teaching leadership, biblical leadership practices to the school system. God isn't even finished there, because the head administrator there, she is the one who pushed for that to happen. She is now getting promoted to the head administrator over all of the United States. And she said, the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to open up and I'm going to make all the school systems in the United States have biblical leadership principles taught to them. God is opening up doors in our country, in our school system, for our young kids, God. Let's give God the glory and continue to worship him in Jesus' name.
Excellent is your name. Your name is strength. Your name is power. A strong tower that makes me safe. And we're crying. Glory, Lord.
'cause you're my healer, provider, sustainer, my savior.
You're my
healer, provider, sustainer, my savior.
You're my
healer, provider, sustainer.
You're my
savior.
You're
my healer, provider, sustainer, sustainer. 'Cause who wouldn't serve a God like serve a God like this. 'Cause who wouldn't serve a God like this? 'Cause who wouldn't serve a God like this? Yeah. You're my healer, provider, sustainer, my savior.
You're my healer,
provider, sustainer, my savior.
You're my
healer, provider, sustainer, my savior.
You're my
healer, provider, sustainer, my savior.
I'll stand to our feet all over the building this morning. There's some needs in the house today. I can sense it in the Holy Ghost. I know it's not hard to figure out that there's needs in the house when this many people are here. But I want some of us just together around the front right now. The Lord showed me months ago that we've got to keep these altars on fire with prayer. And the Lord's showing me this morning that we need to right now ignite these altars in prayer. Right now, we need to ignite these altars with prayer like we never have before. If you feel to come forward and pray, we're just going to be together this morning and pray for a little while. Lord, we thank you, God, today for the fire that's fallen in this place today, God. Lord, we ask you in the name of Jesus right now, God, come down on us like you never have before, God. Just breathe into us today, God. I praise you, Lord. There is power in of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, to break every chain, break every chain. I hear the chains falling. Yes. I hear the chains falling. Oh, 'cause I hear the chains falling. Oh, yes, I do. I hear the chains falling. Chains falling. I hear the chains falling. I hear the chains falling. I hear the chains falling. Of Jesus, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. 'Cause I hear the chains falling. I hear the chains falling. Chains falling. Yeah. I hear the chains falling. Yeah. 'Cause I hear
chains are lit. I hear the chains are lit. I hear the chains are lit. I hear the chains. Every chain, break every chain. So break every chain, break every chain. Thank you.
every step you make. But lean on me and trust in me, for there is no other that you can trust. There is no other that you can trust. It is only in my love that I guide you to me.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We love you, God. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your voice. Thank you for your voice in the darkness, God, and shining in our light, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for illuminating our path, God. We love you, Jesus. Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Sister Michelle, Lord put something on my heart for you, but this is for everyone. But the Lord put it on my heart, and he confirmed it through that word. The chains that have been wrapped around your feet in darkness, they've been clouded, but they are now broken off of you. In that darkness, you can't see the chain, so you think you're still bound. But God is illuminating your feet so you can see that those chains aren't on you. He's illuminating your path so you can start walking to God. Start stepping. Sister Alexis, God showed me that you are bigger in him than you've ever thought before. He showed me that your potential far exceeds your expectations. And he wants you to live in your potential in him. In Jesus' name. Oh, give God the praise. Give God glory in Jesus' name. God, we're going to pray over this offering in this service, God. We ask that you will bless this offering and bless us as we give, Lord, for you give to us abundantly, God. Let us to give back to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore.
God. Hallelujah. Amen, amen, amen. If you have your Bibles, we're going to turn to the book of 1 John, chapter 1 and verse 5 through 7. A couple of announcements. Kids service Friday night, September 10th at 6:30 p.m. I will let you know we are having, I'm just tossed with this. We may cancel the evangelist, have Brother Cole come up here and prophesy to everybody. Amen. Thank God, brother. Amen. I was glad for that. We're thankful for that. Amen. Thank you, Brother Cole, for letting God use you. Amen, amen. We don't need evangelists. We got everybody we need right here can do all the work.
Amen. Oh, Brother Meeks will be with us Sunday. I'll let you know. Just give me a second. I haven't felt any direction. I need to pray just another day or so, and then I'll figure out what we're going to do as far as Saturday night church or Sunday night church or just one service. But I imagine we're going to have an extra service. I'm just not settled yet on the decision. Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
That all right? I'm not settled on it. But, I mean, I'd like to have, just out of curiosity. Now, I'm going to do whatever I feel in the Holy Ghost to do. But out of curiosity, what do you guys prefer? A Saturday night service or when we do an extra or a Sunday night service? Saturday night. Raise your hand. Oh, man, that's weak. Sunday nights. I can't. Oh, we'll see. You got a quarter? We'll do Saturday night and Sunday night. We'll please everybody. Amen. Anybody got a quarter so we can flip this quarter and figure it out? No. Nonetheless, I'll let you know. I'm going to pray about it a little more and make a decision. We have a lot going on. And I was trying to think about ways to not make it all on top of each other. Amen. But nonetheless, we'll figure it all out. Also, ladies' service Saturday, September 18th with Sister Annette Jones, ministering in song and the word. And then she'll be leading worship Sunday as well. Brother Bubba will be here. I don't know. I might preach. He might preach. They might preach. We just might all get up and testify. We're going to figure it out. We're going to follow the Holy Ghost. And I'm going to let them do as much as they can do. If I'm paying them, they're going to do it. I'm going to squeeze every last dollar out of them. You know what? I'm going to work them hard. Amen. Well, the Lord's been talking already. I already knew what I didn't doubt what I was preaching, but he's already been paving the way already. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5 through 7. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5 through 7. Amen. This then is the message which we have heard of him, and declare unto you, somebody say that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. God is light, in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light, even as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. I want to preach for a little while from this thought, living in the light. Amen. Living in the light. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the word of God this morning. God, we thank you for being so good to us. Lord, we thank you, Father, for your mercy, your grace. We thank you for the light of the Holy Ghost, God, that you have shined down, that you have shone down upon us today, O Lord. Through your word, through your spirit, through your presence, God, let the word of God fall on good ground. In Jesus' name, and everybody said amen. 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 You can be seated this morning. Sometimes I get a little bit, not confused, but I don't know which mic I want to use because this mic gets to beating around on my tie and bothering me. And you hear all the fuzz stuff happening. It's not the sound, man. Praise the Lord, Brother Seifert. It's not your fault. Amen. So don't be thinking it's his fault. We love Brother and Sister Seifert here. They are both wonderful people. Amen. I pulled them in my office this morning. I said, get in here. I said, I've been neglecting our friendship. We used to have our Sunday morning meetings in my office before church would start up. He'd tell me all the things God was showing him, and I'd tell you everything God was showing me. We'd get excited and just worship and pray in there before church started. And we hadn't done that in a while, and I said, I've been neglecting it. Get in here. Get in here. Tell me what the Lord's saying. Amen. And I did share in Sunday school the dream gave you, brother, about President Joe Biden. If you want to hear that, you can go back and watch it. Dream he had when before the election, and how that, just go back and watch Sunday school if you want to know what it was. Amen. We don't have time to get into it all today, this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Living in the light. Amen. It's a wonderful thing to have the light of God in your life. I know that's a pretty common elementary statement, but if you've never really lived in darkness, then you can't ever really appreciate living in the light.
Come on, somebody. Has anybody ever lived in darkness before? Aren't you glad that the Lord brought you out of that darkness? He brought you out of that bondage. He's shown His light in your heart. He's shown His light in your spirit. And you had that moment where you said, ah, I see now. This isn't about church. This isn't about religion. This isn't about do's and don'ts. This is about living in the light of God's love and fellowship. It's living in the light of God's presence. Hallelujah. We've got such a church a mindset in America because we've set it up that way. It's all about what happens down in the church house. And I don't care what religion or denomination it is. It's all about what happens at the church house. And I thank God for what happens at the church house. But let me tell you, friend, just because you came to church today doesn't mean you're living in the light. It's whenever you walk out of here with the Lord hand in hand. It's whenever you walk out of here with a praise in your heart and a praise on your lips that you begin to walk in that light. God is shining the light today and you are stepping into it, but there's a difference between stepping into the light and living in the light. You can step into this light every Sunday and step right back out into darkness every single time you walk out of here. You have to insist on walking in the light of God's love. You have to insist on walking in the light of God's fellowship. You have to insist on it because the darkness is ever encroaching upon every one of us. Always. I remember, I don't know who it was, Brother Stephen, he told me, he said, the Lord spoke to him one day and said, hell is watching. Because hell has a vested interest in what we do and what we don't do. Now, God didn't tell us that to scare us, but He told us that to let us know this isn't a game. This isn't just some little religious thing we do on Sundays and Wednesdays, but we're living this thing. We're breathing this thing. We're walking this thing. We're embracing all of God's light. All of it. Whatever light God wants to shine in your life, you need to open the windows wide and let it shine in. You ought to let it shine in. That's the first thing I do in the morning. I got it from my mom. My wife hates it. She's a child of light, but she wants that room to be dark. Oh, she'll be madder than a wet hen if I open up those blinds just a little bit. She's the sweetest thing you'll ever meet, except it's 6 o'clock in the morning. If you turn the light on or if you open up the blinds, it takes her a minute to get the Holy Ghost again. And she's got to get it every morning. She's got to get it every morning. You know what I'm saying, Brother Cole? I got it stepping out of the bed. I don't know what her problem is. I don't. That's not the truth, and you know it. But she does. She don't like that light shining too bright in the mornings. I can flip it on. It don't bother me. But I got it from my mom. She loves the daylight coming in. She fling those curtains open, draw those blinds up, just do whatever. She get all the sunlight in the house. And you need to get to where you love the light, where you embrace the light, even if it means shining into a place of your life that you need to change, shining into a place of life, your life that you didn't even know you had issues with, but you need to invite the light into your life. When you live in the light, God will shine the light in every part of your life. Hallelujah. You see, whenever we live and walk in the light, a lot of things just take care of themselves. What did the scripture say? He said in verse 7, he said, if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. Just happens. There's no struggle for fellowshipping with the Lord when you walk in the light as He is in the light. The struggle in fellowship with God is when you have one foot in the light and one foot in the darkness. When you walk in the light sometimes and you walk in the darkness, then I can't get close to God. I don't hear His voice. There's a struggle there. But when you just walk in the light that God shines before you, Sister Michelle, God was shining the light. He's told you. He said you might think there's, but they're gone. You're going to have to walk in that light in order to have fellowship with God. You're going to have to know, not feel, but know what God has spoken today. You need to go back and watch it, get the exact words, and remind yourself, because the darkness is ever trying to encroach upon us, and in the darkness we tend to forget what God told us in the light. That's why you better hold on to it. You better hold on to it. Get it, write it down, do whatever you got to do. But a lot of things just, they take care of themselves whenever we walk in the light. They do. We have fellowship with Jesus. We have fellowship with the Lord. And the blood cleanses us from all sin. There's just a cleansing power that comes from walking in the light. It's just there. He cleanses you from stuff that you don't even know that you need to be cleansed from. I know that we ought to know our sins. We ought to ask for forgiveness. We ought to repent. But there's some things you don't even know that you need to be cleansed from. I've had God knock stuff off of me before. Didn't even know it was there till he knocked it off. I'm like, whoa. Oh, that feels better. Had no idea it was there. Didn't realize it was there, but God just knocked it off of me. Hallelujah. And he cleansed me because I was walking in the light towards him. I'm getting closer to him. I'm fellowshipping with him. I'm drawing near to him. Hallelujah. It's a wonderful thing to live in the light. You see, we struggle in the darkness, but we walk with ease in the light. We struggle in the darkness. You know, I've often told people being filled with the Holy Ghost or even just the Lord, just turning your mind on, the light of your mind on, the stark contrast between the two is this. Imagine yourself sitting in a room with no windows and it's completely dark, and it's so dark you can't even see your hand in front of you. And then all of a sudden God comes in and he flips the switch and the light comes on. Now you don't just see the hand in front of you, but you see everything in the room. That's why when I became a Christian, I was like, oh, I didn't know that would be a problem. what I thought was just fine all that time. Oh, God don't like that. And it's not that he's trying to be mean. He don't like, but he knows what it'll do to my walk with him. See, God, that's all it's about. Everything God tells you to do or don't do, it's not about controlling you. It's about freeing you so you can have fellowship with him. So you don't walk with those chains. You don't walk in the darkness, but you live in the light of God's presence. See, whenever you live in the light, you know where you're going. We see things that are just ahead of us, just down the road. We see clearly whatever it is that we need to see. And like we did last week, I turned my phone on here. Didn't matter how dark it was. One little small light was able to put off so much light in this room. You don't have to strain your eyes. You don't have to try to focus whenever you're living in the light. You just see, well, what does God really want me to do? What is he really asking of me? Which direction should I go? Which, you know, there's a struggle. But whenever you get in the light of God's love and presence, I'm not saying you don't need to use your faith. You will always need to use your faith, but there's just not as much struggle. There's not as much struggle. I haven't had everything always spelled out for me clearly and knew exact. There's times you just got to take a step of faith. There's just times that happens, but there's other moments where God does. He tells me, especially if it's a life-changing direction, God's not trying to hide his will from you. God's not trying to hide it. If you're praying about getting married and, you know, so on and so forth, well, I mean, there's some things that are obvious. If he or she are not interested in God, you don't need to pray about it, whether it's God's will. I can bring you straight to the Word of God where it says that we ought to not be yoked together with unbelievers. And that's for marriage and friendships. You can witness and help people win them. You know what I'm talking about. Without yoking yourself to them. And so we have to be careful. But God will deal with us. God will show us who God wants us to be with and where God wants us to go. God will. He'll do it. You know, I remember one time God showed me something through somebody. And I couldn't figure out what it was to save my life. And I was on the phone with somebody. I said, you got to help me pray. I have no idea what this, that God showed me this. He said, okay, I'll be praying. And I looked down at my Bible. I got the phone. He said, turn to me with all your heart and I will show my word to you. God said, if you turn to me with everything you've got, I'll tell you what it means. Oh, why don't you just hand it to me on a silver platter, God? Why you got to make this thing difficult? It's not difficult. It's not difficult at all, but God does require some things of us if we're going to live in the light. If we're going to live in the light, you have to insist on living in the light. I said it here before a long time ago, but I just remember the appreciation when I was in the car line to pick up Daniel, and there was those bumper stickers in front of me on that car, and just full of darkness, all kind of different religions, and nothing was Christian, and it was this and that. I don't know if it was one of those coexist bumpers or not, but it was just, hey, I can coexist with somebody without agreeing with you. I can coexist with you. Do it all the time. But it just washed over me. I said, oh, thank you, Jesus, for letting me live in the light. Thank you for the light of your presence and the light of your love. Thank you, Lord, for the light of your mercy in my life, oh God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You see, to live in darkness is to live a lie. People in darkness can be easily swayed because they cannot see. If you're living in darkness, I can say, hey, come this way. This is the way to take. Huh? What? You're going to follow that voice because you're living in darkness, and you automatically assume that that voice has your best interest in mind. Let me tell you, in the book of Nehemiah, that he was on that wall, building that wall, and the Bible said his enemy came and said, hey, why don't you come on down and let's talk about this. And in parentheses, it said, but they thought to do me mischief. There's a lot of voices in this world. It might seem like they have your best interest in mind, but they're thinking to do you mischief. Anything that's calling you down off of the wall of separation from this world. And I'm not talking about clothes. That's good. But that, friend, let me tell you, there's a lot deeper separation than what you got on your body. There's a separation of the way you think. There's a separation of the things that you love. There's a separation of the things that you have in your spirit. We Pentecostals have made it too shallow for too long. There is a depth to separation. It goes way beyond clothes. It goes way deeper than a little bit of jewelry or a little bit of this or a little bit of that. I think those are good things. If you want to separate, I think it's wonderful. But let me tell you, if you separate yourself those ways, but there's no separation in your spirit from worldliness and from the love of money and entertainment, then it's not doing any good. Now, folks, see, he said he don't care. We can do whatever we want now. As long... You missed it. You'd be surprised when people come and tell me I preached after I preached. Brother, let me tell you what the Lord... Oh, my God, I love it when you said this. I'm like, yeah. If it's good, I just go with it, you know. I correct him if it's wrong, but if it's good, I'm like, well, praise God, you need to go home and do that then. God talking to you. God talking to you. I didn't say anything of the sort. Oh, Lord God, that's all right. As long as you're getting something good from God. But you see, people who live in darkness, they can be easily... That's why children growing up in school, they're easily swayed. Because they're living in darkness and all their buddies around them are telling them, hey, look at this. Look what we're doing over here. Let me tell you how it is doing this little thing over here. And, oh, I know they told you it would kill you, but look at me. I'm alive. We did it last night. They're living in darkness too. They're listening to voices in darkness while living in darkness. Amen. They cannot trust what they feel or hear when you're living in darkness because you can't see the source of it. See, that's why it's important to live in the light, because you can see the source of the voice that's speaking to you. Remember? Just recently. I'm not going to... Is it okay if I share just a little bit of it? Destiny and I were talking, and God gave her a dream, and I'm not going to, well, do you mind if I share a little bit of it, or no? I'll say, no, I'm not going to say all of it, but God gave her an end time dream, is what happened. And a man in a black hood with a barcode on his arm walked up to her and said, hey, come on over here, I want to play a game with you. She's like, no. No, we're not. I said, well, thank God, Destiny. Thank God. Thank God. Got some Holy Ghost in her. Got some spirit in her, you know? And so, but somebody she knows was the first one to say, basically, I'll go play. And other people that she knew and family members and friends just of the sort, they went and played with the man in the black hood. See, that was people living in darkness. And he said, come on, I want to play a game with you. And so they followed the man, and he began to give them little square tattoos all over their body. All over. Had numbers on them. And then on top of that, he sedated them and put heavy, heavy little chains inside every little square. And as they began to follow this man and play his games, if they got to a point where they didn't want to play his games and said, no, we're not following you, he jerked the chain out of their body and killed them. Voices in the darkness, come play a game with me. Church really isn't that important. That old preacher, he's just spitting and hollering and screaming. Don't listen to him. Oh, I know you ought to pray, but don't, no. You got better things to do. Voices in the darkness. Don't you think for one second. I'm telling, don't you think they won't speak? Had a voice speak to me one time, roll across my mind, and told me to settle down, become a denominational pastor of a church that don't believe nothing miraculous. They don't expect nothing miraculous. They pray, but they don't expect an answer. They don't, all I'd have to do is go to the hospital, shake hands, pray a nice little prayer, and go home. Nobody's expecting to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Nobody's expecting to be miraculously healed. And all this was rolling in my mind. Just you ought to settle down and just become this kind of a pastor and just go make those nice little hospital visits and just shake their hands and nobody's expecting anything. And all of a sudden I rebuked that in Jesus' name. It was filthy. It was vile. You see, it was a void, but the only thing, there's people that are living in darkness and they hear that and they settle for that. You got to live in the light. And so they had numbers on these tattoos and on these squares, and she asked me what they meant. I said, I don't know. I don't have any idea. And so she got off the phone, and she went in her house somewhere, and she was sitting there, and she said it just like this. A voice spoke to me and gave me a website. So she said, I'll send you the link. And explains, and it, she said, the numbers in this website, it's crazy because it's exactly what happened in the dream. And so I pull up the website, and the first thing I see is astrology and tarot cards. I said, Destiny, that's not God talking to you. God is never going to lead you to an astrology or a tarot card website. I said, I don't care how I don't care what happened in that dream and how much these numbers, get away from that. You see, but because she's a child of light and she's living in the light, she didn't fall for all that. See, she's connected. She's connected to the light. She's living in the light. Always be leery when you say, a voice spoke to me. When God speaks to me, I don't say a voice spoke. I say the Lord spoke to me. I'm confident that it's God. But a voice will speak and it will bring confusion. I'm going to give you a list. I didn't pull this up. Oh, Lord, it's just too good to not do it. Guys, I'm going to pull it up, and I'm going to help you right now. Y'all okay with this? Yes. This is going to, I sent this to Destiny, and I came across, God, I know God gave me this yesterday while I was on the phone with her, but in my old photos that I hadn't looked at in a long time, it says God's voice, Satan's voice. And I don't even know where I got it. Somebody on Facebook wrote it down, posted it. I don't even know who. And I did a screenshot. Here's the difference. God's voice steals you. Satan's voice rushes you. God's voice leads you. Satan's voice pushes you. God's voice reassures you. Satan's voice frightens you. God's voice enlightens you. Satan's voice confuses you. God's voice encourages you. Satan's voice discourages you. God's voice comforts you. Satan's voice worries you. God's voice calms you. Satan's voice obsesses you. God's voice convicts you, and Satan's voice condemns you. It said that God is never early and he's never late. He's always right on time and his plans for you are good. God is a God of love and order. If the voice you are hearing doesn't sound like those things, then they are not from him. They're not from him. I've been in that situation. I'm going to tell you, that voice, it'll make you obsess. It'll make, oh, there's no peace in it. There's no peace in it. So make sure you're living in the light, because you can discern the voice of God much more clearly when you're living in the light. Amen. Living in darkness produces fear. There is an uncertainty life to God and to direction for yourself. Those who live in darkness tend to live by what they feel instead of what they know. They are left to their earthly senses to guide them instead of being led by the Spirit of God. You ever been there? Ooh, I feel this, I feel that. I've been there, I know. I feel some strange, and the devil knows I feel some strange things. So he sends strange things. But I told you half the stuff. I mean, my poor wife, my God, it's just a miracle. She's not on Valium, Xanax, and everything in between. You felt what? You felt what? You did. Boy, quit living by your feelings, she tells me. But it's very real. It's like, whew. I feel a push this way. I feel a tug this way. The enemy can do that. He just wants just to mess with you, just to aggravate you, just to frustrate you. That's all it is, just to frustrate you. Amen. The people that live in darkness, they don't know what direction to walk in because they cannot see what's around the corner. People of faith that live in the light, they don't always know what's around the corner either, but they know to be led by God is to know that the Lord is always right around the corner. Hallelujah. I may not know everything about what's around the corner, but I know Jesus is right around it. So it doesn't matter if it's a better job, more money, or this or that. None of that matters. Jesus is right around that corner. So whatever else comes along around that corner will be just fine. If there's a boogeyman around that corner, Jesus is going to punch him dead square in the face. Jesus is going to take care of the boogeyman. He can do that. Oh man, I've been through, so I've had the devil attack me years ago, and oh man, he'd come into my room. He felt like he was 10 feet tall. I mean, it felt huge, man. I'd just wake up in the middle of the night and I'd feel this pure evil just leaning over me, just, you know, I'd get up out of the bed. I'd go to another room. I was in 2013. I was being attacked day and night. It felt like that dude was 10 feet tall, like he took up the whole living room. And then God spoke one day. He said, he's making himself out to be a lot bigger than he is. He said, it's nothing for me to take care of. That's what the devil does. He makes everything look bigger than it is, seem worse than it is, because he's in the darkness and he can do that. If you don't see me coming, I'm in the darkness and we're both in the darkness, and you don't know how big I am, I have an advantage now. You don't know how big I am. You don't know how bad I am. I can strike fear into your heart, even though I might be 100 pounds lighter than you. The devil, he's a master of trying to magnify things in the darkness. But when you live in the light, you see it for what it is. Is this the man that caused nations to tremble? Is this the man that struck fear into the hearts of all the people? That's what the scripture talks about. It could be twofold, the devil and that king. I think that's what you're going to see when you get to heaven. That's what I was afraid of? That's what I let control me? I love when Brother Jack Cunningham pointed out, he said, one angel. That's it. Not the whole host of heaven. One angel chained up the devil. Didn't even name him. Wasn't Gabriel. Wasn't Michael. Wasn't an archangel. He was just a scrub in the back doing nothing. He was probably cleaning the bathrooms. Just sweeping and mopping in heaven. God said, we need somebody to go chain up the devil. I can do it. I don't want to bother Mike. They're busy. Okay, buddy, put the mop down. Come on, we need you to take care of the devil. One angel. You're not a scrub because you clean the bathrooms. That's exactly who God uses. Amen. Just nobody. No angel. No name angel. That shows us what kind of power the devil has. Not a whole lot. Thank you, Jesus. Living in the light means living in joy. Living in the light means living in peace. In a dark, cold world, living in the light means living in the warmth of God's presence. It means being bathed in the love of God while the world reels to and fro in darkness and terror. Men's hearts failing them for fear, but you're in the presence of God. Your heart is content. Your heart is at peace. Your mind is at peace. Even though you see the world crumbling around you, you can walk in peace and love and joy whenever the Holy Ghost is leading you and you're living in the light of God's presence. You can have confidence in times of uncertainty when you live in the light. You can have peace in the midst of turmoil, joy in the midst of sadness. We serve a good God. We serve an awesome God, and His name is Jesus. Let's all clap our hands to the Lord in Jesus' name. I'm going to try to hurry to a close because I took a little time, but the world in all of its darkness will name anything as its God. Did you know that? All serving the same God here. No, we're not. Doesn't matter how you get there. As long as you get there. No, it matters. Only one way. All taking different roads. We're all going. No, you're living in darkness. You're speaking from darkness. You can't tell me anything. You don't know anything. You're living in darkness. So they don't know who they will name anything as their God because they don't know who to turn to. But the people of God know who to turn to. His name is Jesus. We know who to turn to in times of darkness. We know who to turn to in times of trouble and sorrow and in times of joy. Don't let the only time you turn, turn to the Lord, like I said, in times of trouble. But don't let that be the only time that you turn to the Lord. That's what happens when you live in the light. You don't just turn to the Lord when you're in trouble. You turn to Him all the time. For everything. We have to insist on walking and living in the light. The danger of walking in darkness is this. The Hebrews that came out of Egypt saw the great works of God. They saw the miracles, signs, and wonders. They saw Moses and Aaron go before Pharaoh and curse the river, curse the land with plagues and darkness. They saw Moses stretch out his staff in the Red Sea, part in two. The problem was they had preacher religion. They had preacher religion. What they had. They saw everything God did, but they saw God use man in the process. As soon as Moses goes up into the mount and doesn't come back, they want a calf to worship. They want to create something out of their minds and out of their own ability to work. That's what happens to people that live in darkness. They want to hold on. They want to grab on to things that they can figure out how to do on their own. They want something they can understand, something they can hold, something they can see. But when you live in the light, you don't have to see it. You don't have to understand it. You don't have to figure it out. You don't have to touch it. But you know that Jesus is leading you. You know that Jesus is involved in the process that you're going through. People who live in darkness are always creating something to replace the God that created them. Did you know that? Those who live, and I'm not talking about just unbelievers. If a child of God, go talk to a true backslid child of God who is powerfully, they are messed up. I'm talking messed up. If they truly live for the Lord and were deep in God and walked away, they are messed up. I'm like bitter, angry, mad, don't believe nothing, don't believe in God. I mean, just wild stuff. Wild stuff. They've had to create a God of their own doings that they could, because now they're in darkness and they're not living in the light. They shape and form a God out of their own intellect and their own abilities. And speaking of John the Baptist, Jesus said in John 5 and verse 35 and 36, He was a burning and a shining light, and you were willing to rejoice for a season in His light. But I have greater witness than that of John. For the works which the Father has given me to finish, the same works that I do bear witness of me that the Father hath sent me. He said, I'm glad for whatever light you got out of John the Baptist, but there's greater light on the scene now, and you need to follow me. Thank God for whatever light the preacher was to you. Thank God for whatever light your mom and daddy was to you. But you're going to have to live in Jesus' light. You're going to have to walk in Jesus' light to be able to survive the end times. Their light doesn't shine far enough. It doesn't shine bright enough. Only His shines bright enough and far enough and powerful enough for you to survive. Thank God for whatever light somebody has been in your life, but we're going to have to live in His light. John 8 and 12, Jesus said this, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. There's the key. He that followeth me. He that followeth me. If you find yourself walking in darkness, you need to check your relationship with God and ask yourself, who am I really following? Am I following God or am I following somebody else? Am I following the Lord or am I following my own desires? If you find yourself in darkness, that's the first thing you need to check. Am I following Jesus? Am I really following Him? Because if I'm following Him, I will not walk in darkness. John 12, verse 44 through 46. Jesus cried and said, He that believeth on me, believeth not on me, but on him that sent me. And he that seeth me, seeth him that sent me. I am come a light into the world, that whosoever believeth on me should not abide in darkness. I didn't give you this scripture, but Psalm 68 and verse 1 says this. Let God arise, let his enemies be scattered. Let them also that hate him flee before him. Oh, there is nothing more disgusting than to walk in a house and turn the light on and figure out what's been in that dark. I was in Lake Charles living in a church property. It was not nasty. It was not a disgusting place. I don't know how it happened. The church had bought the place. I've been living in it. You know, I saw a little roach here and there every once in a while. But at that time, I was not aware. If you see one, there's a thousand. I didn't know these things. About had a heart attack. I come in from church one night. I flip on that kitchen like, no! I mean, God, if there was 30 or 40, then I don't even know. They were just everywhere, man. Them suckers just scattered. Got back in their cracks and got back in their crevices because they can't stand the light. Oh, the devil hates the light. You want to run the devil off? Start living in the light. He'll go back in whatever crack or crevice he's been hiding in. He'll go back. You let God arise in your life and the enemy will be scattered. You see, it's not up to me to run all the devils off. Oh, I know we got to cast out. I understand all that. I understand some of that. There's a time and a place for it. But your responsibility is not to run all the devils off. Your responsibility is to let God arise. Let God arise in your life. Let God arise in your home. Let Him arise in your family. Get out of His way and let Him arise. And then the enemy will be scattered. Let's all stand. Hallelujah. Living in the light. Somebody say, living in the light. Say, Lord, I want to live in your light, God. Lord, help me to live, to walk in your light. Not just to walk there, not just to visit the light, but to live in the light, God. To set up camp in the light, to let my habitation be in the light. In the name of the Lord, hallelujah. You see, when I moved to Florida, I didn't come here to visit. I didn't come to visit. So I checked out of the house that I was in Lake Charles. I didn't leave nothing back there. I took everything I love, everything I care about, and everything I needed, and I got in that truck and I came to Florida. I didn't come here just to hang out. Didn't come for a vacation. I came to live. But the only way I could do that is if I left all that behind. The only way you can live in the light of God's presence as if you're willing to move there, not visit it, not take a vacation and enjoy it for a little while, but live there, set up camp there. This is my home, God, in your light. I'm living in your light. There's so much joy. There's so much peace. There's so much contentment. Oh, I see the devil about a half mile away. I'll be ready for that. Oh yeah, saw that come. You see, God, when I woke up before Destiny even called, she texted me. I was tired that afternoon. I just kind of passed out, took a little nap on the couch. And as soon as I woke up, I heard, I don't know what the rest of the words were, but I heard Destiny Williams. Her Destiny Williams. I got up and I looked down, and there was my phone. Destiny Williams was texting me. I said, wow. I don't know all the reason for that. But when you live it in the light, God just shows you things before it happens. He keeps you. You see, when you live in the light, you pray during the day. But have you ever woke up talking in tongues or praying in the middle of the night? Just praying, something coming out of your mouth. I've done that before. Just sit up in bed and, oh my God, something coming out of my mouth praying. That's what happens when you live in the light. You're not in this thing alone. The Holy Spirit of God will help you and visit you even while you're sleeping. I just got to believe the way you look over your children when they're sleeping, that no matter what they've done, no matter how they've acted that day, when you go in their room and look over them sleeping, you're not thinking, that little, ooh, I'm going to snuff him out while he ain't looking. No. You could have had a terrible day and you go in that bedroom like, that's my boy. I just got to believe that's how God is with us. That no matter what, he's there at night while we're sleeping. That's my boy right there. Ain't no devil going to get him while he's sleeping. I got his back. That's my girl. Hallelujah. Living in the light. Insist on it. Let's all worship the Lord in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you tonight, God. Today, God. We thank you for your grace and your mercy, oh God. We thank you, Lord, for the wonderful things you're doing, God. We thank you for the light of the Holy Ghost, God. We thank you, God, for your wonderful presence, God. We thank you for the light of your presence, the light of your love. These altars are open today if you want to come and worship and pray around these altars and just let God bathe you in his light today. Let God bathe you in his love today. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We embrace the light. We invite the light. We welcome the light of your grace in Jesus' name.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to feel the same old holes inside, there's a better life.
Thank you for letting the Lord use you and be emboldened.
We've all run to things we know that just
awesome,
ain't right.
Because
there's a better life. There's a better life. If you've got faith, he's a pain taker. Hey!
chain breaker.
You know why you're a believer today? Because he's shown his light in your heart. You're not a believer today because you were raised in America, nor because your daddy was or granddaddy was a pastor, or because of any of those things. You're a believer because he's shown his light in your heart. You ought to thank God for that. I want us to pray before we leave for Brother Braniff and Sister Braniff. I always call them that, but that's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about Brother Charles Braniff Jr., and Sister Braniff, and also Shanna. They need the help of God today. Let's pray for them right now. Lord, we ask you to touch Brother Braniff and Sister Braniff, God, and Shanna, Lord, we ask you to touch them right now. God, touch their bodies, touch their hearts, their minds. Lord, minister, God, to them in Jesus' name. Lord, heal their bodies, touch their bodies. Bless them and be near to them, oh God. Lord, we bind together in agreement, God, and we intercede for them in the mighty name of the Lord. Lord Jesus, we give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen, amen. Also keep the Cook family in prayer. Sister Margie said, I don't remember who she said, somebody in their family passed away, a cousin or the Cook family. So let's keep them in prayer as well. We love you all. God bless you in Jesus' name. We're dismissed.